A very good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have apologies this morning from Pauline McNeill and Katie Clark. Before I begin, I want to pay tribute to firefighter Barry Martin, who has sadly died following the tragic fire at the Jenner store in Edinburgh. And on behalf of all members of the Criminal Justice Committee, I want to extend our deepest condolences to Barry's family, his friends and all his colleagues in the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service. We know that he will be greatly missed. Our first item of business today is an oral evidence session on the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Bill. We're joined by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans and his officials. So I welcome the Cabinet Secretary and his officials are joining us online. I welcome Jennifer Stoddart, Community Justice Division, Philip Lamont, Criminal Justice Division, Lindsay Mackay of the Criminal Justice Division, Ruth Swanson of the Legal Directorate, and Jamie McQueen, Legal Directorate, all with the Scottish Government. And I refer members to Papers 1 and 2, and I intend to allow up to around 90 minutes for this session. And I would like to now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement, and then we'll move to questions. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you very much, Convener. And can I just echo your remarks in relation to Barry, the firefighter who has sadly died. It was recorded at Cabinet, the Cabinet's condolences to the family. I think the First Minister has written to the family, and the Minister for Community Safety, who has responsibility for the fire service, has also written to the fire service expressing the government's condolences. Just demonstrates how much we rely on people in these very difficult circumstances. The provisions within this bill seek to reduce crime and reoffending, and that's the best way to keep victims and our wider community safe, in our view. The bill does that by focusing on two critical parts of the justice system: the point at which bail and remand decisions are first made by the court, and then release from prison. And reducing the use of remand is an explicit call that all members of this committee have made in the action plan that you've agreed and sent to the Scottish Government. And also, if you think back to the debate that we had in the Parliament last year, I think all parties made that demand to see a reduction in the numbers of people held on remand. And that call for action, which echoes the calls of many others, is responded to in this bill and recognises the damaging impact of remand. Remand removes people from their homes, their families, their jobs and their communities. And remember, at that stage, they could well be innocent of the crime with which they're charged. So we have to remember there are people who have not been convicted of a crime, of the crime they've been accused of, but rather only accused of an offence. And from a victim safety perspective, Professor Fergus McNeill described it as follows. Imprisonment, whether it's for remand or in particular short sentences, is not a magic box that removes or eliminates risk and keeps us safe. Imprisonment is actually more likely to serve as an incubator of risk, so it stores up problems of harm that might come later. And obviously those downsides can be incurred even if the person, as I say, turns out to have been innocent of the crime of which they're charged. So the challenge that we all face is, if the proposals in this bill are not your chosen proposals to reduce remand, then what are those proposals? What lies at the heart of the bail reforms in this bill is an absolute commitment to individual decision-making by the court, aligned to public safety, including victim safety, and the recognition remand should, as much as possible, be a last resort. And these ambitions of protecting public safety and using remand as a last resort can coexist. Indeed, in the evidence you've already heard from Professor McNeill and others, they complement one another. Remand will continue to be needed, and the new bail test explicitly recognises this. There are occasions where remand is necessary to protect public safety and victim safety, and again, the new bail test allows for this. And there are occasions where remand is necessary to protect the integrity of the criminal court process to ensure justice can be delivered, and again, the bail test proposed allows for this. And there are situations, or these two examples are situations where remand can and should be used as a last resort. For people who do not pose a risk to public and victim safety or who do not threaten delivery of justice in a case, there has to be a better way to support them in their communities, including supporting them to turn up at court for their trial. This bill and a new bail test is one of the ways the government is responding to that call for action. But it should be viewed as part of a wider programme of work already underway, and that work includes increased investment in bail assessment and bail supervision services, the introduction and rollout of electronically monitored bail, and action to reduce the court backlogs, which have reduced by at least 13,000 since last January. The bill proposes a more prescriptive bail test. That's mentioned by some of your witnesses during your sessions, and I'd say that up front, it is more prescriptive. But it's prescriptive with a purpose, namely to ensure remand is used only as a last resort. So where public and victim safety requires remand, or where delivery of justice in a case requires remand, the bail test allows the court to use remand. And I know that the committee has also heard a range of views about the proposed removal of Section 23D, and I have listened to those, some of those sessions, and have read the transcripts from those. Section 23D is the current restriction on bail for certain accused persons, and the bill proposes to remove Section 23D for one simple reason, so that in all cases the same core bail test with public safety at its heart applies. You'll have heard there has been support from those who use bail law for this simplification measure, although I can also understand why some concerns have been expressed, and no doubt the issue, that issue will be discussed this morning. And the words public safety have been part of bail law since 2007. There was wholehearted support for that step at the time, including, I know she's not here today, but Polly McNeill, I think. And nobody indicated at that time the need for a statutory definition. And I'm not aware of any cases where the lack of a statutory definition has caused an issue. That's the context of the debate I know members have been having. So if I can just explain a little bit the government's approach. The bill does not include a statutory definition of public safety, but there is a definition, and that is the ordinary meaning of the words. In legislation where the ordinary meaning of words is meant to apply, it's common practice not to include statutory definitions. So for the word safety, the Oxford English Dictionary meaning is the state of being protected from or guarded against hurt or injury, freedom from danger. Therefore, offences, the nature of which pose a risk to safety, would be those that would threaten to cause hurt, injury, or which present a danger. The word public has been held in case law as meaning either the public in general or a section of the public, as the context requires. So the ordinary meaning definitions reflect the policy intention of the meaning of the phrase public safety in the bill. As such, we have to ask the question, what benefit is to be gained by adding a statutory definition? And also, it's worth pointing out that including a statutory definition is not without its own risks. There may be unintended consequences if the definition is limited unnecessarily. However, I would say to the committee, as with all aspects of this bill, I very much welcome the committee's views in this area in the Stage 1 report. If the committee does take the view a statutory definition would be beneficial, I would be interested in the committee's thoughts on what a statutory definition should include, and whether specifically it needs to be different to the ordinary meaning of the words public safety. And turning now to briefly part two, release from prison. Ensuring that those leaving custody have their basic needs met on release is critical for a safe transition back into the community. It reduces the risk of reoffending, and surely that's what we're all trying to achieve. It results in less crime, again something we all want to see, fewer victims, and it also provides for safer communities. And that's why the bill includes reforms to improve pre-release planning and through care support provided to individuals on release from prison, recognising that a range of universal services have a role to play. And I'm sure that we can all agree that those principles are important. And lastly, just to touch briefly on resources, in particular the role of justice social work, which I know has been a focus of your deliberations so far. The provisions in this bill recognise the critical role justice social work plays in supporting people and keeping our communities safe. We recognise that the enhanced role of justice social workers in the bill carries resource implications, and they were set out in the financial memorandum informed by engagement with Social Work Scotland and COSLA. And I don't have to tell anyone here, I hope, that the financial landscape is extremely challenging, and we will need to continue to make difficult choices, but despite those challenges, we have continued to protect the community justice budget, such that in 23-24, the Scottish Government intends to invest a total of £134 million in community justice services, and that includes £123 million to local authorities. So we will continue to engage with Social Work Scotland and COSLA on the future resourcing requirements of the bill. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary. And I know that some of the issues, in particular that last point that you made regarding resourcing, will certainly be the subject of members' questions. Can I just ask, in the spirit of a smooth session, if you would like to bring in an official, if you let us know who that is so that we can press the right button and bring them in quickly.
Okay.
So we'll now move on to questions. And if I may, I'd quite like to ask an initial question touching on the issue of why make changes to, in particular, the law on bail at all. And that's something that has come up during our evidence sessions. Aren't there other options that could be considered that would still meet the objective of reducing the demand population? And I note that in the policy memorandum, it refers to the Criminal Justice Committee's own report, Judged on Progress, in which we called for a reduction in the overall numbers held on remand, and that alternative approaches were considered. However, I think it was the judiciary, they set out that meaningful change in how custody is used would require specific legislative reform, and that's also included in the policy memorandum. And I note also that the consultation, the Scottish Government consultation on the bill, indicated that just under two-thirds of respondents agreed that judges should only refuse bail where there are public safety grounds for doing so. So if we're seeking to reduce the remand population, I wonder if you can outline a bit more about how the sort of status of bail that's placed on somebody can be changed or improved so that it's more effective as a sort of community-based option or measure, both in terms of supporting the person that is subject of that bail status, but also the wider public and particularly victims.
Okay, thanks, Convener. And as you say, many respondents did point to the need for legislation. I think, I can't remember which one, but one of your academic contributors was very clear on that. I think also another member of the judiciary, who's also speaking for the Howard League, also mentioned the need for that in this area. So how would it improve things? And I think your point, if I'm correct, Convener, is about how can people have more faith in the bail supervision side of it? I think, first of all, if we can get it right in terms of those who are given bail, such that there's public confidence around the fact that the interests and victims of others and others, and by others you could mean juries, where there might be a threat of jury tampering or intimidation of witnesses and so on. If we can get that right, then of course the it must mean that the ability to be more effective in terms of bail management starts off in the right premise. But beyond that, bail supervision, I think there has been the case. There's not been, if you like, the shrieval or judicial confidence across the country that's been there in the past. So we have given more money over the course of the last year to improving that. I think we have 30 now local authorities providing that, with the other two scheduled to come on stream. In addition to that, where the bench may consider electronic monitoring and want to have confidence in that, we're now up to 21 of the local authorities providing that, with the intention that gets rolled out across the board. And of course, there are technological and as yet untapped existing potential for that to go further, a much more nuanced use of electronic monitoring as well, whether confined to a particular location or whether to ensure or monitor whether a person is taking drugs or alcohol, which could exacerbate things. So I think those are the ways in which we, by providing the resource for that, can help matters. And going back to the, if you like, the input, who's on bail, having the provisions that we do propose in here for justice social work reports, I think gives us a better basis, not just to the court to decide whether to grant bail, but also to those that will be undertaking the bail supervision. Mm-hmm. What are the points of concern here? What has to be looked after? So I think those things together, I think, will make for a more effective bail supervision and will give more confidence to the bench in taking those decisions as well.
Thank you. I know that members will probably ask some more questions about the resourcing side of things. I would like to just sort of follow up with a kind of practical question around this broader role of criminal justice social work that's outlined in the bill, in terms of it, how it informs court decision making. Now, so far we've received a lot of evidence from witnesses that indicates support for this proposal. However, in terms of the practical implications, in particular the resourcing and the time issue that can come into play around that. So, for example, the judiciary articulated a concern about, and I quote, unnecessary detention of individuals while information is gathered. So I'm assuming from that the potential for somebody to be remanded, albeit for perhaps one day, while information is gathered. So, and this could be a particular challenge in rural areas, for example. So I'm just wondering if you can outline a wee bit more about how that might be addressed.
I think there's no question, as many of your witnesses have said, there's going to be a demand, resource demands, especially in justice social work. And the ambitions of the bill have to be met by that resource provision being in place. And I think it will take time to make sure that happens in advance of the bill being commenced. And it has to be the case that we must minimise any delay that there would be. That's the intention there. And, of course, it's the responsibility of the government to make sure, along with others, to make sure those things are in place. However, just say there was a delay in a case where the Justice Social Work report then came in, where it wouldn't have come in previously, and that allows somebody to get bail, then if you're talking about that delay, however it would be, hours, possibly a day, compared to the number of days or weeks, months even, that somebody might be on remand, there's a substantial benefit there to be had. So I think what we said is we recognise we put more money in this year. I've given you some of the figures already, and this year I think an extra, I think it was £15 million split into two chunks, £11.8 and £3.2 million for these specific purposes to increase the bail supervision capacity that we have. So that's the way we'd intend to meet it, but we're not at all denying this is going to present a resource demand.
Thank you. I think there'll be some more questions to cover that in due course. So I think, Colette, you would like to come in, followed by Fulton. Colette.
Yeah, it's just picking up as well on the resources element of it. And one of the things that Professor Fergus McNeill mentioned was the justice social work presence within each of the sheriffdoms. And we've taken evidence to suggest that they're not always present. So there's lack of uniformity across each of the sheriff courts. So I was just wondering if, in terms of resources, is that something that you are looking at within that bill and how you would tackle that?
Yes, well, we're obliged to, in any event, in terms of the financial memorandum that will accompany the bill. But in addition to what I've just said, we have provided, I think it's about £53 million in the current year to try and reduce backlog and to make other provisions which will impact in this area to try and make it more a more effective service to the courts, should they wish to do it. But the fact is that the current provision does not require the level of justice, just to state the obvious and make the point you've made, doesn't require the level of activity or presence from justice social work as will be required by this bill. So necessarily, justice social work is going to have to be present to a much greater extent. It's going to have to step up to do these things to make reports as quickly as it's able to do. So on the one hand, Justice Social Work's going to have to step up, and on the other hand, the government's going to have to find the resources to make sure they're able to do that. So I think that's recognised. I've mentioned the figures currently which we put in. I've mentioned, of course, the fact that the bill will have to be accompanied by the financial provisions as well. So we understand that challenge.
Okay. Just on resources, in terms of recording the reasons for refusing bail as well, do you have concerns that the parties in the case are not aware of why bail has been refused, and also the resource element of that, and what is it is really intended purpose, really? Or is it to ensure that we can carry out research on bail and remand going forward? If you could just elaborate on that, that would be great. Thanks.
I actually think this is one of the really interesting parts of the bill, because as you've kind of hinted at in your last point, that what you will get from this is a seam of really rich information which others can use, which is the statement by the court of why bail was not granted. And I think that will lead over time to greater refinement of these decisions as well. So I think some of the academic witnesses that you've had have said this as well. They think it will be a really rich source of information where very limited information currently exists. So I think that's perhaps a main benefit. I know it's another process for the court to go through, but I think it will be extremely productive. And I wonder if, I'll try and get the right official, if Philip Lamont wants to comment on that. Yes, he's put his hand up. I've got the right person.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, the only thing I would add is, in terms of the resources, it will impact on Scottish courts and tribunal service, because they will have to adjust their IT systems so that this information can be recorded. But we think that will be manageable through a phased implementation. And as the Cabinet Secretary said, the aim of it is to increase our collective understanding, the Scottish Government, Parliament and others, into why remand is used. Because one of the main challenges we had, and I think this committee has had, in understanding how remand is used, just the dearth of actual data as to when remand is used. There have been some one-off research pieces done in recent years, but this will actually, over a period of time, develop a rich source of information, and that's the aim of it.
Okay, thank you. No further questions.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Fulton and then Russell.
Thanks, Convener, and it's very much in the same area as Colette Stevenson. Good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and his team. As about the resourcing of the Criminal Justice Social Work to do this, I mean, you've actually answered the first part of my question, Cabinet Secretary, in response to Colette, as I said. But what? How do you see it working? Will the government give any direction or guidance to local authorities, or potentially in the future the National Care Service, about how the teams are, how the team could be developed? Because obviously just now you've got, well, every area has got a community justice team which deals with the community payback orders, etc. And then most areas have some sort of court team, which is usually pretty small, with maybe Glasgow being a somewhat exception. So do you see it being more about the court teams that, you know, get this resourcing? How can we ensure that the court teams get this resourcing? And is that effectively how you see it working?
Well, I think, as Philip just said, there will be that demand. You're right in relation to Justice Social Work services to step up here. However, there's also demand in the court service as well, as has been described. So I think in relation to the Justice Social Work and the relatively uneven provision across the country, I've mentioned how already we're taking steps to improve that, and we've seen improvements over the course of the last year, and that's by providing additional resource. So what we're doing is, as part of the bill, we've been involved in discussions with local authorities and with Social Work Scotland. And it will be for local authorities, as ever, to decide how to deploy the resources they have. But at the bottom of this is going to be that statutory requirement for these services, for the court to have these services. Mm-hmm. So we're going to have to meet that. And the task for us now is to make sure that we build on the additional resources that we've already provided to make sure that Justice Social Work has the resources to do that right across the country. So that is the challenge. I think it's... As I say, we currently invest a total of £134 million in community justice services. That includes £123 million to local authorities, and we've made a specific investment this year of £3.2 million to support bail assessment and supervision services. And that's having an impact, as I've said, with more local authorities. I can't remember where we started from at the beginning of the year, but it's now a service available in 30 authorities. So that gearing up has started already, and we know it's got further to go, and we have to provide the resourcing for that. But that will be detailed in a financial memorandum, and it will be as a result of the discussions we have with COSLA and Social Work Scotland.
I mean, I personally, in bringing my own personal experience, think this could work with, for want of a better word, a beefed up social work teams across the country. And I think that, you know, that you could almost get a mirror image of what happens in the community justice teams with community payback orders, with bail supervision, which could be really beneficial right across the whole system. We've also heard quite a lot of evidence, as you'll know, from witnesses quite supportive of the aims and principles of the bill. Our own advisor to the committee believes that the bill is a good way to bring about the policy memorandum. So it is all very positive, but a lot of it, everybody's coming back to, is going to be about resourcing, and not just the government giving those resources, but also those coming in. So I wanted to ask you about the bail supervision aspect of it. Do you see, when this bill is implemented, those bail supervision teams being much more robust, much more work been able to be done with individuals, and therefore courts having a lot more faith in it?
Well, that's the two sides of it that you rightly identify. On the one hand, we need to get proper bail supervision services in place, and one factor which underlies our concern that we didn't have that level of consistency across the country is the measures and the resources we've put into making sure that happens over the course of the last year. So that is the one side of it. You want to have effective bail supervision, but the other side, the critical side for some of the intentions behind this bill, is to make sure the courts have that confidence. And you will see, I think, I'm not sure I saw it in the evidence that the committee had, but I think I'm happy to acknowledge the fact that there's a variability in the confidence that different sheriffs will have, depending on whereabouts they are in the country, at least hitherto, as to how effective bail supervision. But if they are confident that bail supervision is there, then I think that's got to be lead to a more proactive approach from the court, saying, well, we know this is a real alternative and we know it's a safe alternative, so that's the route we're going to go down.
Thank you. Just one more question, if that's all right.
Can I maybe just move things on and then I'll come back to you, Fulton?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, thank you. I'll bring in Russell and then I'll bring in Rona.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to begin by also echoing what your words about the firefighter, Barry Martin, and the tragic loss of life. So in terms of resources, we've heard from your ministerial colleague, Kevin Stewart, that the National Care Service, we won't know until late 2024 whether criminal justice social worker will be part of that. Do you have a view on whether it should or it shouldn't? And do you have a view on what impact that might have in respect of this bill?
I don't think it'll have an impact on this bill as it's going through, given the timescale that you've already mentioned. I do understand the arguments, many arguments for and against, but one of the crucial ones, I think, for inclusion is the fact that Social Work Scotland themselves believe that the entire profession being under the one umbrella is very important. However, I do think there's a difference, and I know this is probably not helpful, to give both sides of the argument, and there are quite a lot of different arguments on both sides. But the other side of it is there's a different nature to justice social work from other aspects of social work in terms of court-ordered and various other aspects of what they do as compared to other social workers. So it seems to me in that context, the right thing to do is build up a body of evidence, which is what we're currently involved in doing, to support whatever decision is finally made on that. And I was keen at the earlier stages when we were discussing in government the National Care Service that we did do that first. We're doing it with a purpose behind it to see how effective we can make it if it is to become part of the NCS. But we are willing to listen to if that body of evidence comes back and says, well, no, that's not the most effective way to do it. So I think that's the right way to do it. There's any decisions you're taking based on the best evidence possible. I think there's another aspect to your question which I've forgotten. Was there?
No, I think we covered it. Yeah, thank you. Going back to the financial elements, we've got some additional written evidence from South Lanarkshire Council who suggest that, by their calculation, the additional burden on their justice social workers would come in at £700,000 a year. But they actually think that's an underestimate because that's based on quite dated figures from the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service. Given that's just one of 32 local authorities, and it's, you know, you can only imagine that this financial burden could be quite significant across Scotland. Is the financial memorandum as it stands realistic, or in light of these concerns, does that need revisiting?
Well, I think we'd always listen to local authorities, but interestingly, I think that the COSLA spokesperson with whom we carry out these discussions primarily is also from South Lanarkshire Council, I think I'm right in saying. So, of course, we listen with local authorities, and it will often be the case that we'll have different views on it, but we have to evidence those views. So I think it should also be seen in the light of the increased investment which has already taken place up to this point. And I think one of the things which was done this year, which I think is really important and not always easy to achieve, is that you, at the same time as trying to encourage some authorities who are not providing these services at all to get off the ground to provide these services, you don't want to punish those that are currently providing the service, so you have to help them improve their services as well. And I think we did that very effectively with, I think, a split of, I think from memory, £11.8 million and £3.2 million for different purposes. So we have funded these things already. We're not starting from a standing start, but of course we'll continue to have discussions with both COSLA and Social Work Scotland. And this is part of the general process of trying to find exactly what the resource requirements are. And I don't think that this committee, nor any other committee of the Parliament, gets through many evidence sessions where the issue of resources does not come up and it's often contested. But we will try to reach an agreement with COSLA in relation to this.
South Lanarkshire Council will make an interesting suggestion as well, that given the additional burden on them and their social work department, that funding should be transferred from Scottish Prison Service to local authorities. I don't know if they mean that the Prison Service would pay for the services that the council would provide, or whether a government would be required to reduce Scottish Prison Service funding, which I'm sure Theresa Midhurst will have strong views on, and divert it to local authorities. Do you have any thoughts on that idea? Is that something you might support or explore?
No, but I think what might be underlying the point there is that if it's the case, and we're very careful not to make any projections based on this bill about the reduction in the remand population, but if you see a reduction in the prison population, that obviously makes resourcing slightly easier, if you like, for the prison service. So maybe their point is that a successful implementation of this bill might lead to savings which might help them get further resources that way, and it's a reasonable observation for them to make. But no, we're not looking to cut the prison budget to fund any of this.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Rona.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary.
Morning.
I would like to ask you, as I've asked practically all the witnesses, about Section 23D, and you spoke about it in your opening statement. I was having difficulty understanding the support given for the removal of that. And after a session with our advisor this morning, I'm much clearer in my mind about that. He described 23D currently as a kind of red flag, you know, just to sort of mark out. But he also said that, you know, if bail was refused in Section 23B and C, then it was almost redundant, Section 23D. Given that, I put it to him that obviously the message going out is perception to domestic abuse victims in particular and women's organisations, possibly not a good message. You spoke about one safety test being applied, and, you know, with the removal of that. I'm just going to ask you if, you know, one safety test applies to the very unique nature of domestic abuse, where it's individual risk and not necessarily public risk. Mm. And so it's just to reflect the concerns that stand around this. Could you agree?
Yeah, and I'm not sure I could be any more articulate on this point than many of your witnesses. Yeah. You'll have heard from the Law Society, the Faculty of Advocates, even Sheriff Mackey and others who don't believe this was a good measure. They weren't entirely certain why it was introduced in 2007, and they believed I think I'm right in saying that it did to some extent fetter the court as well when it was trying to make a judgment. But I think you're right to put your finger on the potential concern there. But I think public safety, just to say, is going to be at the heart of it. It will be, I think, the case, although it's obviously for the courts to decide, that virtually anybody that was refused bail under 23D is likely to be refused bail under the new test, but it does bring more consistency. So it specifically includes the concept of victim safety, which is important to the point you're making about victims of domestic abuse as a factor when making a determination on the person's entitlement to bail. It actually goes further in saying that any assessment of the risk should be both physical and psychological harm to the victim. So Section 3 does remove 23D, does remove that part of the 95 Act. It doesn't remove the protection for victims, as a new bail test will be applied in every case. And repeal does not mean that those accused of serious offences who pose a risk to public safety will now be admitted to bail under the new test. And that's because the type of offences that 23D covers, sexual offences, domestic abuse offences, violent offences, are all offences the nature of which relate to public safety, and that includes complainer safety. So, as such, accused persons remanded under 23D at present might in future, I think, in many, many cases, also be remanded under the proposed new bail test. And that also has essential considerations to justify remand on public safety grounds where relevant. So I think that will help keep the complainer safe from harm. And of course, as I've said, not directly related to the categories that you've referred to, but it goes further in terms of people that might prejudice the process, intimidation of witnesses or complainers, or even potential juries as well. So I think I would hope that would reassure, and we're working with different groups to make sure that reassurance is provided.
That's important. I think it's just getting the message of reassurance out there. Because at first glance, the perception is that, oh, you know, that's the red flag removed, the safety net's gone, but it's not that really when you drill into it. So that's helpful. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. I'm going to bring in Jamie in a moment, but I wonder if I can maybe just come in with a question around sentencing where a person was on bail but subject to a curfew condition. Just interested in how you would respond to the argument that time spent on bail subject to a curfew condition should not be a substitute for time spent in prison as part of a custodial sentence.
Yeah, I think the other side of this, the other side from the points that Rona Mackay has rightly made, is the rights argument for everybody under the system. And whether we like it or not, everybody has rights, and they're underpinned by the European Convention and other legislation. And this Parliament and its legislation is obliged to follow them. So I think, first of all, it's important to say, on remand generally, you are fundamentally affecting somebody's right. You're locking them up, just to state the obvious point, when they've not yet been convicted of a crime. That's why we think it should only be done in the circumstances you've mentioned. But also, if you're putting somebody on bail that's subject to, for example, electronic monitoring, you are curtailing their rights. Mm-hmm. You have impacted on their rights in a number of ways, the freedom of movement and so on, and being monitored by the state. So I think we need to recognise that. And I think leaving the courts with the discretion to recognise that, I think, is important. And it's done in other jurisdictions as well. So I would be supportive of that being taken into account.
Mm-hmm. OK, thanks very much. I'm going to bring in Jamie. Jamie Dean.
Thank you. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I'd like to just ask a few perhaps more philosophical questions about the nature of the proposed legislation. Obviously, it comes in two parts, the first dealing with the issue around bail and the parameters around the court's decisions, and the second around release from custody. You said in your opening statement that the intention of the bill is twofold, to reduce crime and reoffending. I wondered if you could explain to the committee which part of part one of the bill around narrowing the conditions for bail and remand will reduce crime and reoffending.
Well, I think the quote that I read out at the start by, I think it was Professor McNeill, is quite useful in this philosophical discussion, where he said that the idea that Remanding somebody reduces or eliminates the risk. I forget the exact quote that he used. I do think, and he said, there is an increased risk sometimes. If you imprison somebody, especially in situations where they're then found to be innocent of the crime against which they're charged, then I think you increase risk by doing that. Somebody's then put into the prison system, and I know that we would all agree sometimes currently because of the pandemic for longer periods than we'd otherwise like to see, sometimes for months. I do think you are increasing risk through that process, and with that increased risk, I think it's not recidivism in that case because they haven't committed an offence, but I think the likelihood is... bear in mind that these days the prison population in Scotland is much more violent and sexual offenders, a far greater proportion since the presumption against short sentences has passed. So if that's who people are then being incarcerated with, even when they're innocent, I think there's bound to be a risk attached to that. I think that's what Professor McNeill was saying. So I think that's where the increased, that's one area at least where the increased risk would come in.
But isn't that by its, what you've just said, isn't that by its very nature vindication that judges and sheriffs are sending people to prison on remand because of the nature of the types of offences that they're in front of the courts for? So, I mean, there is this sort of perception, I think, or at least the government are stating that we do have a high remand population. As you know, the committee previously criticised the government for that. But is that because too many people are being sent to remand in the first place, or they're spending too long on remand? Because those are two very different things, and they're dealt with very differently. This bill seems to address the latter by implying that too many people are being sent to prison on remand, rather than addressing perhaps what is the real issue, which is the fact that there are not too many people being sent to prison on remand, but they're just there for too long.
Yeah, I think the length of time on remand, as I've just conceded, has been exacerbated by the pandemic. It's true of, I think, every jurisdiction. But the concerns about the high levels of remand in Scotland predated the pandemic. This has been a long... I think this committee's predecessor, 2018, their report at that time said exactly that. But it's been said many times. And we still have, compared to England and Wales, we have a higher remand population, although theirs is growing very, very fast. And we now have a higher prison population in England than we have in Scotland. The first time, I think, in many years, they've seen a huge increase, a 50-year high in terms of their remand population, although still not as high as in Scotland in terms of remand. So we are sending more people to remand, and we are trying to deal with that, but we're also dealing with the other point, which you rightly make, about how long people are spent on remand. I mentioned that the reduction in terms of the backlog, although I concede it's mainly in the summary side rather than the solemn side, is now over 13,000, which is a fantastic achievement over the course of the last year, down from 44,000 odds down to 30,000. So we are tackling that. We're not blind to the fact that, of course, I've just made the argument to you that being remanded can have a negative effect on risk. Being remanded for longer increases that risk. I concede that point, and we are trying to deal with that as well.
Okay, so here's what I don't understand, though, is we're using legislation to reduce the remand, or that the intent of the bill is to reduce the remand population by sending fewer people to prison in the first place. And there's been a debate, I think, in amongst the judiciary of whether the bill will meet its objectives, because there seems to be a school of thought that remand hearings will just progress as they currently do because of the lack of clarity around the changes to public safety issues. But the government seems to think it has quite an ambitious reduction in the numbers. But if we go back to 2015... the remand prison population in Scotland was just shy of 20%. So over the last 7 years, that's increased to nearly 30%, which is probably where it sits about at the moment. Can I ask what's driven that? So what over the last 7 years has resulted in our remand population rocketing? What legislative changes have taken place that we're trying to reverse? Or why is legislation needed to address what seems to be quite a short-term spike in the increase in Oman population, when historically, actually, it was there or thereabouts, and in fact, is favourably comparable to England and Wales as far back as the year 2000, and at the moment is still considerably short of many other comparative small countries with a similar population, such as Denmark, Sweden and Norway, who have Oman populations of 30%, 39% and 25%, so they're not low either. So I'm trying to get my head around why the government is using legislation to address what seems to me a very marked but short-term increase.
As I hear, I don't think it's... obviously, it's easier for me to talk about the time that I've had responsibility in this area, but I don't think it's a short-term increase, or I don't think the concern has been just a recent one. I've mentioned 2018. I could actually read out the quotes from various members.
Yeah, I know you've got quotes, but the statistics are, in the year 2000, the Oman population was 16%. 2005, it was 17. 5 years later, 18. 5 years later, 19. So it's creeping up, I admit that, by around 1% every 5 years. But it jumped by 2022 to nearly 30%. So what happened?
The pandemic is a major factor in relation to that. Obviously, with the court system having to operate on an extremely restricted basis, then that's the result of that very large increase that happened, which other jurisdictions have seen as well. But on the one hand, you know, I think many of your witnesses have said that they do believe quite explicitly from their expert position that legislation is required to change this. And I do think if you go back into the history of this, there have been a number of attempts trying to almost by persuasion, respecting the different independence of the courts, to try and achieve this reduction in people on demand for the best of reasons. It's not been effective, and we believe that legislation is required. I did mention, and I won't read them out, but there are quotes, demands from individual members of this committee to deal with the demand situation. There was no distinction made at that time between legislative and non-legislative measures to do it. Just get on and deal with it. And I did say in my opening statement, this is how we think we should deal with it, based on information we've got. If there are other suggestions, and I've actually asked the individual, if you like, stakeholders within the justice system, if you've got a suggestion as to how we can do this, please do it. And just to correct a couple of things, we have not said that the primary purpose of this bill is to reduce numbers in prison. We haven't made that statement. We have had to give, I think there's been some indicative figures of what a reduction might look like by one of our stakeholders, but this is the purpose is to make sure that only the people that need to be held in custody are held in custody. That's the primary purpose, and we think this is the best way to do it.
So is it your view then, or is it the government's view, that the wrong type of people are being remanded? Because again, looking at statistical data, the nature of offences is really, really enlightening. What has happened over that period that I mentioned, where there has been a huge spike in the Oman population, is the nature of the offences for which people are held on remand. So crimes of violence has doubled over that period. Crimes of sexual violence have doubled. And at the same time, crimes committed by people on bail for similar offences has been markedly high. So there were 40 murders in Scotland committed by someone on bail, and 770 attempted murders or serious assaults. And again, that number for rapes and attempted rapes is high as well. So from what we can see, it's really, we're not sending low-level criminals to prison on remand. In fact, 1% of summary cases end up in remand. It seems to be that the high number is at the High Court in those solemn cases where the offences are grave and serious. So is the government suggesting that there are people who are currently on remand for those serious offences that should be walking the streets? Because this is what I can't get my head around.
I think, first of all, it's not for us to say whether people on serious offences, if the court system has been wrong in relation to that. Although I think one of your expert witnesses, and I'll maybe come to Philip, he'll have the exact reference to it, said around 21% in their view of prisoners did not need to be on remand. And the point of the bill, one of the points of the bill, is also to take into account the gravity of the offence as well as the likelihood or the risk of further offending. And, of course, to have a sensible estimation of the recidivism, the offending rate of those on bail You really have to compare that to what it would be if they'd served in custody. The two rates, I think, are a very useful comparison. So we do think there are people that, and not necessarily in relation to serious crime, I've just mentioned the fact in response to Rona Mackay, the vast majority of people, I think, that are currently remanded under 23D are likely for the same reasons to be remanded in future. But we do think there is a cohort that need not necessarily put in remand, and it would be useful to hear from Philip in relation to that as well, if you could, Convener.
Philip, would you like to come in?
Thank you, and Cabinet Secretary. And just to add, I think there was a figure maybe the Cabinet Secretary was referring to, about maybe 21%. I think that might be a reference a stakeholder indicated to the committee about the number of people on remand who might then not receive a custodial sentence, which I know the committee have been looking at. So ultimately the focus of the test is to ensure that those who need to be remanded as a last resort are, and that's the focus on public safety, including victim safety and prejudice to justice. And on the question of serious offences, clearly violent offences, sexual offences, serious domestic abuse offences would be caught by that test. And so the government has not predicted in the financial memorandum that there will be a particular reduction in the use of the remand. It's just that the test will be more focused, so that as people flow through the system, the court has to apply that focused test in the future. And from that should be a more focused use of remand, but it will be for the court in each and every case to make that decision based on the cases they are dealing with.
Just on the point that Philip's made there, so one of the criticisms rightly raised last year was the fact that you might have somebody on remand for a longer period than the sentence that they eventually received. Or you might have somebody on remand, kept in custody with other criminals, who is found not guilty, but you could have somebody who then receives a sentence which is non-custodial. So we've kept them in custody for that period of time, even though the crime of which they've been convicted is judged by the courts to be deserving of a non-custodial sentence. So it's to capture that as well, I think.
So we heard from evidence last week from Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, and I'm happy to ask this to Mr. Lamont and the Cabinet Secretary, from David Fraser, who said, I've managed to determine the number of people who are on remand and awaiting trial in our legal system. In summary cases, only 1% of people on remand. For sheriff and jury cases, it is 12%, and for High Court cases, it is 27%. That contradicts what I've just heard from Mr. Lamont, who says that if, by the very nature of those types of offences, those people will probably likely be held on remand anyway, even under the new rules, surely that then contradicts the purpose of the legislation, because if you're trying to reduce what you would consider, Cabinet Secretary, as people who are held on remand but don't need to be, but at the same time we're saying that people who commit serious offences and rightly should be held on remand will still be held on remand. So the two don't add up. So either those people will still be held on remand, or we'll be letting them out with bail conditions. So I'm a bit confused as to what the purpose of the legislation is, because it's clear from the statistics that the lion's share of people held on remand are there through High Court cases, which are normally quite serious cases, which normally will result in a custodial sentence.
Yeah, perhaps the lion's share is not what we are looking to tackle here. It's the other part of it, if you like, but I think,
but that's only 1%. So summary cases are only 1%. So the very few summary cases are, very few people in a summary case are held on remand, which is where you'd actually think the bulk of it would be, in which case there absolutely would be a problem. But it doesn't seem to be a problem.
Well, that doesn't necessarily relate to the nature of the crimes of which they're accused. It does to some extent, I realise that. But I suppose I'm a little bit confused. What is it within what we propose in the test that's proposed that does not go far enough to capture more people that you'd be concerned about? I say this because I think the discussion with the committee is also to be a bit of a dialogue. I'm happy to be questioned, we're generally looking for other people's ideas in relation to this. So if there's a category of people that we're not going to capture with these proposals, I'm happy to hear that. But yep. I don't know, since you've asked Philip about a contradiction in his statement, maybe we should hear from Philip too.
Philip, would you like to come in?
thank you. I think it'll be for others to judge if there's a contradiction. I suppose I would just make one point about summary cases. Obviously, the volume of summary cases is much higher than solemn, including High Court. There's thousands more cases of summary cases a year. So even 1% of summary cases is a significant number of people, albeit perhaps for a relatively short period, who are held on remand. And so the undue harm that can be caused through short periods in custody, even if proportionately it's quite a small number, in absolute numbers can be a significant number given the volume of summary cases that go through the courts each year.
I mean, I could talk all day on this subject, but I appreciate there are lots of other members, but I'm happy maybe to come back in if there's time later.
Thank you. Okay, Russell, you want to come in, and then I'm going to come back to Fulton.
Thank you. In one of your earlier answers, you spoke about sort of philosophical issues around bail, and this question is going to be an attempt at a hybrid of a practical and a philosophical question. So, in terms of some of the evidence we've heard from Victim Support Scotland, they've got serious misgivings about the bill. You'll be aware of that. They effectively say more bail equals more crime. The Scottish Police Federation have said to us that, quote, it's another good day for criminals. However, the social work academic kind of lobbyists to kind of put them into one group are largely supportive of what's being proposed. One of the contributors from that side of the argument used the phrase a risk appetite, and that struck me as being quite interesting. The point they were making is, and this is the philosophical part, the public need to almost be persuaded that the risk in changing the system quite radically may lead to more crime in the streets potentially, and that is just a quid pro quo in the benefits that you would get from not having people in remand and so on. So given what Jamie Green's just said about some of the serious offending that takes place by those in bail and the inevitability that that will continue no matter what the system, do you think the public have the appetite for that risk? And what can you do as the Cabinet Secretary to perhaps persuade people about this direction of travel? And it's quite philosophical, but...
I'm just very surprised and delighted to be asked by both the Conservative members to get involved in a philosophical discussion about this, which is a pleasant change.
Highbrow.
Just to say that I can't really talk to the interpretation that whichever the academic was that you're referring to put on this. I would acknowledge, though, that risk is a part. I think I've said this in the Chamber recently. Risk is a part of the justice system. It's a part of every justice system that I know of. Happy for anybody to point to me a justice system where, whether it's parole boards or courts or other parts of the system, don't have to balance risks on a regular basis. So I acknowledge the risk that's there, but I think what we're trying to do is to minimise those risks. And you can argue, going back to an earlier answer I gave, that by reducing the numbers of people that are on remand that don't necessarily need to be on remand, you're also reducing risk. So I think there's an element of this bill which helps to reduce risk. And of course, the part which we've not really got onto so much just now, part two, is also designed to substantially reduce risk. So I would say the package of proposals we're making is designed to reduce, and we're not asking the public to trade risks, to accept a higher level of risk. We think we are trying to minimise risks. But you started off by saying there are quotes from, as if there was a dichotomy between different groups of witnesses. I mean, I've got a number of quotes from Victim Support Scotland that are supportive. I think Kate Waller said, it seems to me one of the main purposes of the bill is it will potentially strengthen the approach to public complainer and victim safety, and also given the size of the remand population. So there is, I think, also from the police, I can't put my hands on it just now, there are also quotes, I think it was the police was there when you mentioned, supportive quotes of what we're doing here as well. It's probably never going to be the case that we'll get either everyone to agree that's not going to happen, or that people who do agree with it will agree with every part of it, or people who disagree will disagree with every part of it. I accept that, but in the end result, the purpose of government is to show leadership in relation to this. So we're putting this forward. But I think at this point, it is really important to reiterate the point I made before. I think it was possibly Jamie Green that said in the Chamber, we have to, or whoever it was said, we have to wrestle or wrangle with this issue. It might have been Paul McNeill, forgive me if I'm wrong. And that's what we're doing. And we're not saying that we've got a monopoly on wisdom. If people have got better ideas how to do what everybody here says they want to do, which is to reduce remand, then please come forward and say this is the way to do it, and we're happy to look at that.
Yeah, I mean, I understand the Victim Support Scotland produced a considered evidence, some of which was supportive of the intent, but it remains that they believe that the outcome will be more people being mailed, more people committing crime, and indeed police evidence, the Scottish Police Federation's position was different in parts to what Police Scotland had to say about it. So, but it's just worth putting those views to you on the record, I think. So, thank you.
Thank you. Thornton, do you want to come back in? If not, I'll come in with a question.
What I was going to ask is sort of has now been more or less covered and this conversation's moved on from, so I'm happy to leave it, Camilla.
Okay. Can I bring you in a second, Rona? I wonder if I can maybe just come in, Cabinet Secretary, and just ask a couple of questions around release planning and through care support for prisoners. So within Sections 9 and 10 of the Bill, they seek to improve release planning and through care support. So can I ask how the Scottish Government will ensure that relevant bodies involved in release planning and through care will be resourced and the capacity to implement the proposed changes will be sufficient for them?
Well, first of all, there's the legal aspect of it, whereby we'll name public bodies who will have an obligation then, a legal obligation to engage in pre-release planning. Now, I would say that I'm aware of different practices across the country. In Barlinnie, there's some very good practice in a particular location on the prison estate where different bodies get involved and talk with prisoners in advance of the release quite effectively. I think it can go further. So, for example, somebody being released, say they live in the Western Isles, say they're released on a Friday afternoon, say they've got an addiction problem and they have no house to go to. Mm-hmm. I mean, that seems to be setting somebody up to fail, in my view. So the idea that local authorities and others will be named to make sure that planning is done before that person's release, so they can get to where they need to go, that they will have the support they need. I'll give you one example. I know the committee went to see New Routes through in Glasgow. I don't know whether you got the same example that I was given of one of the chaps that was there saying he was released by the Friday of that week. He'd ended up in a pub. He didn't have alcohol addiction, but he did have drug addiction. Mm-hmm. And because he felt particularly low, that temptation was there. He, in that case, I think was maybe not saved as the right idea, but he was hugely helped by the mentor, the scheme that they have there to prevent that going any further. But if that support is not there, you can see where things end up. And it's got to be joined up so that transport, someone's housing options, social work support if that's required. So I think those things are too hit and miss just now. We have to be more coordinated in the way we do that. Most local authorities, where they have responsibilities, are resourced to provide those services in any event. It may change some configuration. And, of course, we're always willing to look at resource implications for it. But the idea, and it would be useful, I think, to hear from, hopefully I can get 100%, it'd be Jennifer in relation to answering at this point. The idea is to make sure that's joined up across the country. Mm-hmm. I think it's I would hope uncontentious that we have to better prepare people if we're going to reduce crime in the future. But if I've missed anything, maybe Jennifer could add something in, convene if that's all right.
Yep. Jennifer, would you like to come in?
Yes, of course. Yeah. I don't have a huge amount to add to what the Cabinet Secretary said, other than just to confirm that is the intention in particular of Section 9. So I know that the Chief Inspector of Prisons, when she gave her evidence, she compared it to hospital discharge planning, which is what we were thinking of when we developed the provision. That planning starts at a much earlier point than sometimes happens in someone's sentence. So you don't end up with a scenario that the Cabinet Secretary described where people are released with a list of appointments, but that's very difficult for them to navigate. That what should happen increasingly, because of this provision, along with other supports that are put in place and the release planning that SPS do, that person leaves with clarity about what their support package needs to look like, and that where SPS are identifying these needs and they are able to engage with those universal services at an earlier point.
Can I just add, convener, a point that when I went to Perth Prison, it was made, I suppose it's probably something to be obvious to members of the committee, but the point was made to be seeing some of the people in the, I'm not sure it was a recovery cafe, but it was a social space where prisoners could gather, that this was the least least chaotic period of their lives being in prison. And the scariness of going back into society is a huge thing and trying to cope with that. And that's partly what this is about. And I'm not, just to be absolutely clear, I'm not drawing any analogy between veterans and people that have been in prison. But I've also been making this argument for a number of years with the MOD that on day one of somebody joining the armed forces, they should be given the right to sign up to the local authorities' housing so they can get points for housing for when they eventually, even if they're not in the slightest bit interested. Yeah. And similarly, we still have not cracked the point of the MOD giving the health records of individuals leaving the armed forces directly to a GP to make sure that that's seamless. So a GP is informed about what that person's been through when they get them. So it's a similar thing, starting at the very start of the process, but especially towards the end of the process, if you can get people more likely to have a rounded support package when they go into society, there's less chance of them reoffending.
Yeah, absolutely, and I agree with all of that. And it kind of brings me nicely on to a follow-up question. This was raised, and it's been raised in committee, but it was raised recently when I was on a visit to HMP Grampian, and they spoke about how planning for release should actually start the day that somebody enters prison. But one of the scenarios that it is difficult for prisons, for families, for stakeholders supporting an individual is where release from remand is unplanned or not anticipated. So how, I suppose what we're grappling with is how we make that process less volatile, perhaps less unpredictable, so that in those circumstances there is something put in place that supports that individual where their leaving prison is not planned.
I'll come back to Jennifer, but you're absolutely right, Convener. This has been raised and it's a problem that we're wrestling with, the unexpected release, yeah, straight from the dock, which can happen for a number of reasons, how the agencies can gather around to make sure there's maybe a different demand that's called upon in those circumstances that most frequently happen to somebody that may well have been on remand, but for a short period of time. I don't know if Jennifer wants to add or put some detail around that.
Jennifer, come in.
So this is an issue, exactly as you highlighted, Convener, that's been raised with us, and it was something we asked about in the consultation to inform this legislation. The reason it's not in the bill is the view is that it actually doesn't need legislative change, but it does need some operational change and some practice changes. So, for example, Section 7 will be intended to, will apply to remand and sentenced prisoners. Section 9, I beg your pardon, will apply to remand and sentenced prisoners. So what increasingly we would hope would happen was at least for those remand prisoners, there will be a better understanding of what their needs are, so that when they go to court, if they are to be, they can go with that plan. Now, if they're released, then there at least is an assessment of what their needs are, and there can be some engagement with whichever the most applicable agency is. I'm not saying this is a solution. This will need a number of things to change. But having better information and earlier planning for individuals when they leave custody has got to be a good thing. And we are working and developing work with Prison Service and others around that cohort, exactly as you described, that go to court for a hearing and are released and it's not necessarily expected. And what can be put in place to support those individuals. And it's difficult for everybody. Sometimes they're not with SPS for very long and that release is unexpected. There's not an easy solution and it doesn't necessarily need legislative change, but it does need a better understanding, I think, of those processes and information sharing that follows those people.
Thanks very much. I don't know if you want to add anything to that, Cabinet.
Well, just say, if the cultural change which the legislative change makes, which results from the legislative change, which is to say that people, the service, the prison service, is aware of the need to plan from the early stages, that can also apply to people on remand, yeah, but it's got less time to have effect. I think we'd acknowledge that. It's also true, though, that if you're on remand, you've often got access to other services like navigators who will be helping in that process as well. But I would acknowledge that's an issue and it catches just now too many people by surprise, and they have to be alive to it.
Thank you. Rona, do you want to come in?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, I'd like to ask you about emergency release. The coronavirus bill has restrictions in it, and they were added during stage three proceedings, which meant that it restricted the period of early release to no more than 180 days and prevented the release of prisoners serving sentences for domestic abuse offences. Will this bill be amended to reflect that in any way, or I'm just wondering why that's not in the current bill, those restrictions?
I think that's a fairly good prediction. That I think it was Mr Finlay that proposed an amendment previously, and I think we are looking at how we can do that at stage two as well. Yep.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Russell, you want to come back in?
Yes, thank you. So, just generally talking about prisoners being released, one issue the bill addresses is to stop the release of prisoners on a Friday or indeed at the cusp of a bank holiday period. This being to, you know, provide them with the support they need not to reoffend or to find themselves in dire straits. Now, there are some pretty tragic cases, not least the 2019 murder of Alan Geddes, which I'm sure you're familiar with. That this individual had helped a prisoner who had been released from custody with no support, it seems, and ended up being murdered by him within 24 hours of that release. His family are happy for me to mention this, and I think it illustrates the seriousness of the lack of support. Now, one of the issues that Jennifer Studdart mentioned a moment ago was the need for operational changes rather than legislative changes. And I suppose what I'm asking is, in terms of the bill reducing the days in which people can be released, would it not have been better, more practical, to fix the system and allow for Friday releases and have the networks that exist presumably on the other days of the week, you know, rather than shrink the system, strive to have one that actually functions and protects people?
Well, I would say, I think if I'm right in saying the particular case that you mentioned, I don't want to go into details, but I think the murder took place in the kitchen. It was a horrendous, if it's the one I'm thinking of, a horrendous case. And I would just offer my condolences again to the family concerned. However, in relation to this, I think if somebody thinks that the Friday release change is not the appropriate way to go, the idea is to provide 7 days a week or 24-hour services, then by all means, put that as an amendment. You would, I think, have to quantify the cost of that, which I don't think would be nugatory. It would be very substantial. And I think there's also real questions for the people to be providing those services and having to provide it, whether overnight or 7 days a week. So we do, and some of these services, we don't control these services directly. They're provided by the third sector. So I think this is the better route. It responds to demand we've had many times over the years to not have the Friday releases for the reasons that are mentioned, so we can better enable those support services to be available to people being released. So that's the route that we are choosing. But again, happy to consider any amendments that people put forward.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Jamie, I think you want to come back in.
And I'm pleased to be having an interaction with the Cabinet Secretary rather than just the question and answers, because I think it is a discussion and hopefully a constructive one. But one of the issues that I think perhaps arose as we got to understand how the system currently works is, obviously we've spoken around the parameters that the bill changes about public safety testing and changes to that. We've talked, I think, at length around the remand periods, and that may be another way of addressing it. But the third aspect which struck me is the use of opposing bill by the Crown. And it seems to be that whilst there are, of course, final decisions made by sheriffs or judges, but certainly the deputes on the day in remand hearing courts are pretty busy, to say the least, dealing with dozens of cases and spending probably very little time looking at each individual case, especially if those are people who've been held on remand over the weekend, and this is a Monday court, for example. Is there any thought or feeling in the government that there is overuse of opposing bail by the Crown? Because that would clearly also alter the numbers quite substantially if the Crown opposed fewer bails as the cases came through the remand custody hearings. And if that's not the case, then what more could be done on the day by empowering the deputies to make more instant decisions rather than centralised decision making from above, that would clearly lead to an inevitable of fewer people being held on remand, because it seems to me that the sheriffs listen to what's been said by the Crown and take their views on board, and if bail's not opposed, it's probably going to be granted. There are probably very few cases where the sheriff will just go straight over the Crown's head and say, no, you should have opposed bail in this condition. So I just wondered what the thoughts were around that, because that struck me as an area that we haven't really gone into much detail on.
Yeah, I mean, I think Philip's contribution would be useful here as well, but from my point of view, I think that is quite... it's more than a tricky area for the government to get involved in, which is to say that... I think you've seen, short of legislative measures, how would you have that kind of interaction? I think that's very tricky for the government to get involved, given the independent nature of the Crown Office. I know, as Jamie Green says, that you heard evidence from some saying legislation is a legitimate way to do this. That's what the role of legislators is, but it's not our role to get involved in that kind of, if not direction, even influencing of the independent service. And it's not my position that it's overuse, but I think you also had, you had some evidence from some members of either the judiciary or the legal community who felt that they were currently constrained in terms of when they had to refuse bail. But I don't know if Philip wants to add to what I've said.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. One thing I would just add is just to reflect on, I think, what the Crown Office representative said to the committee just last week, which is that the position that the Crown adopt on bail is, of course, shaped by the legal framework. And so if the legal framework changes, they will have to change their approach. So there is a specific quote from Kenny Donnelly where he explicitly says that the Crown, in the future, there will be certain instances that it will be not open to us, the Crown, to oppose bail anymore. And that's because the legal test changes. Legal test applies to the court, but the Crown have to consider it because they can no longer oppose bail if the legal test does not support it. This is a way in which the legislative change, which impacts directly on the court, can actually feed through the system and influence the Crown Office, but not threaten their independence, because ultimately it's, they have to operate within the law set by Parliament. So that's one of the ways why legislation, we think, is part of the answer here. It's not the only answer. That's why legislative change is quite important, because it helps filter down not just on the court but through the system to others who are involved in the decision making.
That's interesting, I think, because I think you said it's not really for government to interfere overly with decisions made by the Crown, but actually if we make legislative change, that will alter their behaviour and decision making.
I think the point though that I'm trying to make is the public looking at that will know exactly what the legislators have done, and they'll know what discretion is afforded to the Crown. Whereas if it's a result of a backroom discussion between us, that then I think it's less transparent. So we've stuck to our legitimate role as legislators of providing the framework, and they stick to their role and independently come to the conclusions they do, but having regard to what the legislators have put in place. So I think it's more transparent. People know where the influence is, and that's why we've chosen this route.
They did actually, you mentioned Kenny Donnelly, Mr. Lamont, but he did raise one particular concern which I don't think we have properly addressed in the bill, and I hope we do as the bill moves forward, and that's the issue in relation to Section 23C, which removes from a summary court the ability to oppose bail for people who simply have a record of not attending, or, as he says, about whom there's information that they will not attend. That wouldn't necessarily fulfil the public safety criteria based on the ordinary meaning definition that you described earlier. So how do we counter that? How do we ensure that courts do have that ability to remand people where there is a significant risk of not appearing or attending future hearings? And we know all the implications that come with that, both the cost, financial and human cost, and of course court time, which is precious. And it seems to be that they feel like their hands may be tied in that respect.
There is another aspect to the test, though, which does cover that in terms of the administration of justice, and Philip or someone else can come and detail that. And it's a legitimate concern, although I think what we're saying is the safety test will dominate in this area. When we talk about the administration of justice, and as I say, we can get the exact words, I couldn't put my finger on it right away, we're also talking about things like jury tampering, potentially, or intimidation of witnesses, but it's also about continued willful non-appearance at court as well. But whether it's the case that if you're worried that somebody might not appear in court, and for that reason you remand them, which is the greater harm that's caused here? Remanding somebody for, and you've just said that these things can get delayed for all sorts of reasons, so it could be for quite a lengthy period, somebody kept in jail at the taxpayer's expense, not presenting a safety risk to the public, but simply in order to avoid the possibility of non-appearance. So I do think the obligation is to make sure that we get better at making sure people appear in court when they're meant to appear in court. I understand that risk. And I speak as somebody who represents an area that had a very particular problem with this, one of the worst in Scotland, and then the police took particular actions to try and remedy that. So I think we have to do more than that. But just on your point about the test, maybe if Philip can just fill out the text that I've unable to bring to mind.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Yes, so to confirm that what's proposed in the bill is that where someone is appearing in a summary case, not in front of a jury, the less serious end of the system, the ground in Section 23C relating to failure to appear will not be available to the court at first instance, unless the person themselves has been accused of a failure to appear. So in effect, it's to reflect that at that level of the system, we don't think remand in the first instance is appropriate where there isn't a public safety risk. Public safety will still be available. The administration of justice test will not apply. And that reflects the feedback we received to the Scottish Government consultation, where initially there wasn't a proposal for the new bail test to include an acknowledgement of the administration of justice, prejudice justice test. So what we proposed in the bill is a direct response to that, which for solemn cases, High Court, Sheriff and Jury, that test is available, but in summary cases, person, as long as they're not appearing on a failure to appear related offence, or they haven't already failed to appear, that will not be an option to the court, and bail must be granted. And that's where support in the community must be available through the steps that we've discussed today to help ensure as much as possible that person attends.
Okay, so in solemn cases, that test could still apply and would be grounds for remand, but at summary level, not. So that is a removal of that ability. And we do know that there are people out there who are taking the proverbial with the system, who are repeat offenders at summary level, who don't appear regularly. And there seems to be no way of now holding them on remand as a result of that behaviour, which is unfortunate, I'd say.
Well, what Philip just said, though, is even at summary level, where non-appearance is part of the case against them, then that can be taken into account, unless I'm getting that wrong, Philip.
Yeah, at summary, but not. Well, that's not my interpretation of what I heard. But I'm happy to. Perhaps you could write to us, or I'm sure.
If part of the case against them is related to non-appearance, then it can be taken at summary level, could be taken into account. But we'll write with clarification on that.
Okay, because bail-related offences are rocketing. They were 18% 5 years ago. We're now sitting at 26%. So there's a real problem with bail-related offences, which I presume will only get worse if more people are on bail. So anyway, I move on.
Okay, thank you very much. I wonder if I could, we're just under 10 minutes away from our sort of scheduled time with you this morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wonder if I can just come in and ask a question around release on licence of long-term prisoners, which is contained in Section 7 of the bill. So Section 7 of the bill provides for the release of long-term prisoners on a reintegration licence, and it provides for this in two situations, before and after the parole board has recommended release on parole. So in relation to the second of those situations, we took evidence from John Watt, who's chair of the parole board, who advised us that it would need a power to reverse its decision on parole if an offender fails to comply with the conditions of release on a reintegration licence. So my question is just if there is a plan to amend the bill to provide for this power?
There's not a plan to amend this bill because this bill does not affect... It's not a result of this bill. The issue that's been raised by the chair of the police board, he's raised it and it's a concern for him. I don't deny that, but it's not an effect of this bill that will change. That's the existing situation. We are willing and are engaged in discussions with both the chair and I think also with the parole board, happy to confirm that on this issue. It actually opens up a number of other issues as well. That's why it's probably not suitable for dealing in terms of this bill, but it's a live issue which we have been and are discussing with the chair. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thanks very much. Any other questions? If not, then Fulton. Okay, I'll bring in Fulton and then Jamie.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just a quick question on information for victim support organisations. We have heard some concerns about information being shared under Section 11 of the bill without the consent of the victim. Are you able to talk about that, Cabinet Secretary?
Yeah, I think the concerns expressed, if I'm right, are about the idea that victims should consent to any information being shared. What I would say is I don't think there's any track record of victims' organisations, I'm sure you would agree, acting against the interests of victims. I think this is a bit more complex than it first appears, but we are willing to have further discussions on this. It might be useful to hear from Jennifer in relation to this. We've not set ourselves against this just for the sake of it, and I think our view is probably understood by the victims' organisations. So I think we're having a continuing dialogue, but I don't know if Jennifer, you want to add to that.
Yeah, it's exactly that. Within the legislation, that consent was implied, and the evidence that you've received from victim support organisations and the engagement that we've had with them is they would prefer that to be explicit on the face of the legislation. So that is something that we are looking at actively and how that might end up being in the bill. I think, as the Cabinet Secretary said, there's no indication that does not happen in practice, but there is a clear preference from the VSOs that is explicit.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Jamie, do you want to come in?
So this was an issue that came up, I think it was in last week's session, perhaps another, on evidence that we had from the Parole Board Scotland, who made a specific call to the government, which I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary's advisers have taken note of, but he said there may be some benefit of an independent judicial body deciding where it would be appropriate for the parole board to make decisions on temporary release. So this probably falls into that conversation around what powers ministers have in relation to powers that parole boards have. Is that a piece of evidence that the government has taken cognizance of and plans to address later in the bill?
Once again, I think it would be useful to hear from Jennifer, but just to say, as you've probably gathered from number of the contributions that I've made today, and including specifically the last one, there are areas where we are, and also Rona Mackay's previous point about exclusions from emergency release, there are areas that we're listening to people. It's the way to do this. It's generally a bill trying to find solutions to problems that we all agree with. So we are still involved in that discussion, but it is a very tricky area for the reason that you mentioned, for us to get involved in directing the parole board, given its independent powers. But I don't know if, Jennifer, you want to add to that, and specifically with reference to the evidence that's been mentioned.
There's a couple of points. I mean, as the committee are aware, the parole board do have a role in relation to Section 7. That's obviously why you heard from Mr Watt, whereby where the prison service, Scottish ministers of prison service, are making a decision as to whether to release an individual on a reintegration licence in advance of the parole board's consideration of their release, they have to consult with the board for their views, and that reflects the parole board's expertise in risk-based decision-making. I suppose it's also important to recognise the prison service's expertise in that area too. So transferring responsibility for making those decisions from the prison service, who make those decisions on a dynamic basis, to a different body, that's quite a significant shift, and that is not something that is within the terms of the bill, as you know, is currently drafted, but the bill does recognise the important role that the parole board plays and will play in relation to helping inform those decisions.
I think if you think, convener, to the emergency release powers which were used 2 years ago, one of the caveats in there was the prison governors would have essentially a veto over an individual prisoner, which they didn't think was right to release. So I think it's recognising, as has been mentioned by Jennifer, the fact that there is real expertise, in fact, there's closer experience in the prison service than anywhere else. So I think it's important to keep that expertise there.
Can we clarify that, though? I think this is, because it is a matter of law, is that if the parole board make a take a view on someone that they can be released, and I think this came up as an anecdote last week, but that person commits an offence during that short time frame, and it is quite possible gets into some sort of form of infraction or breaks the rules within prison, what would then happen is that they seem to think that they do not have any further powers to stop release happening, even though there's been a further incident after that decision has been made. Will governors have a veto on those decisions, or will ministers have a veto? Because it's unclear where the power actually lies in that scenario.
Well, if I'm getting this right, I think, first of all, if somebody's released on temporary licence, if they breach their licence, then they can be recalled for that reason. If they commit an offence, that will be a breach of their licence conditions. Same as if you're paroled. You're paroled on licence, and if you breach your parole requirements, you can be subject to recall at that stage. So that power is there in law. I'm not sure it has to be exercised by either the parole board or the prison service. That is a consequence of you breaching your licence. But given that we're talking about a point of law, I don't know if it's okay, convener, if Jennifer wants to add more to that.
Jennifer, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I think the point that Mr Watt was making and that Mr Green's highlighting there is where the parole board have already recommended release and that decision is taken in advance of PQD, and there's a bit of time before someone's parole qualifying date, the parole board can direct that person to be released on reintegration licence as a way of better supporting their reintegration. If they don't comply with the terms of that licence, as Mr Watt described, the parole board do not have the ability to reverse the parole decision, and that's not made by this bill, that is an existing situation. But we are engaging with the parole board to see what can be done in relation to that. It is a legal point, as you make. That's not an operational thing. That is a legal point, and it is something that we are actively considering with the parole board.
That was the first. I think back to the first question that was asked about this, which is it's not an effect of this bill. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. And final, very quick question.
Okay. It's to do with bail. One of the inevitable consequences, indeed the intended consequences, there's going to be more people on bail and therefore greater reliance on supervised bail, such as electronic monitoring. We've heard evidence from some academics who take the view that 2 days on these conditions should be a direct trade-off effectively towards any future sentencing, sort of a ratio of 2 days of those conditions to 1 day in custody. Do you agree with that? And indeed, does the bill factor this in any way, or is it not part of it?
Not in that detail that you've mentioned, but the principle, yes, that courts should be able to take into account when sentencing, not time served, but if somebody's been subject to electronic monitoring. I think this is, I tried to answer this point earlier, that is a diminution of your rights, and I think it should be taken into account by the court when sentencing.
But will the bill state it in a prescribed way, or is it going to be entirely discretionary?
Not on that level of detail. I mean, I'm happy to have any of the officials that Philip has put his hand up there, but not in that detail. But the principle, I think, yes. Philip, I don't know if you want to add to that.
Thank you.
There's a bit of discretion ultimately sits with the court. So the court has to decide how much of the time should be accounted for for the purposes of time served. So if, for example, someone's on EM bail for 6 months, for example, the court has a decision to make whether all of that 6 months should be accounted for, or some of it or none of it. So, for example, if someone breaches, then the court probably would not give them any allowance on that. But if they are well behaved, there's no compliance issues, then the court may say 6 months on EM bail, and then there's a formula which says 6 months is converted into 3 months, 2 days to one. So that would then count for the purposes of the custodial sentence. And this is based broadly on a similar scheme that's operated in many years in England and Wales. So the principles of the scheme are based on legislation in England and Wales, although there's some differences of detail.
But is it any different to how things operate just now in terms of judicial discretion around those decisions?
Yes, at the moment the law would not permit the court to take those things into account. There is case law that says the court wouldn't take those things into account, so this provision is needed to give discretion to the court. They use the discretion to work out how much of the period should be accounted for, and then to ensure consistency, formula kicks in, which the bill has 2 days for one. So there's a bit of discretion and then a bit of prescriptiveness.
Okay, thank you very much indeed. So that's just taken us a little bit over our time. So thank you very much indeed, Cabinet Secretary, and all your officials for joining us this morning. And that completes our public agenda items, and we'll now move into private session. Thank you. Thank you.